Jordan Peterson is a Canadian professor of psychology who, in just a few short years, managed to become a world-famous writer, lecturer, and the occasional subject of the culture wars. This video is not about him. Instead, it's about two books that he brought to fame along with him, The Gulag Archipelago and Ordinary Men. The former is a first-hand account of leftist atrocities from the perspective of their victims, while the latter is a historical investigation of rightist atrocities from the perspective of their perpetrators. So it seems to me like these two make for a natural comparison. So you can call me Ezekiel. This is The Gulag Archipelago versus Ordinary Men. Let's jump in! Now, before an atrocity can have victims, it must have perpetrators. So let's start with Ordinary Men. At first glance, the future war criminals of Reserve Police Battalion 101 seem like what the cover promised, just a bunch of normal guys, and if it were true, that would be pretty terrifying. But when the backgrounds of these men are explored a little more carefully, it turns out they weren't exactly an even cross-section of ordinary German society. Because, if anything, the men of Reserve Police Battalion 101 should have been some of the least likely people to perpetrate Nazi atrocities. The battalion was mainly composed of older working-class men from Hamburg. With that background, the unit should have been more inclined to be communists than Nazis, and their age meant that they grew up in a world before Nazi rule, so they weren't brainwashed as children. As the book put it, "By age, geographic origin, and social background, the men of Reserve Police Battalion 101 were least likely to be considered apt material out of which to mold future mass killers. The unit was not sent to Lublin to murder Jews because it was composed of men specifically selected or deemed particularly suited to the task. On the contrary, the battalion was the dregs of the manpower pool available at that stage of the war." The first atrocity the battalion committed was at a town called Josefo, but their leaders were aware that the unit wasn't exactly mass murder material, so they waited until the last minute to tell the policemen that it was going to be their job to round up and murder civilians. When the unit finally was told, they were disgusted, but none really did anything about it. A few managed to slink off and not participate, but that didn't do anything to actually save the victims. Meanwhile, others only stopped after rounding up and murdering several people. When interviewed by German authorities after the war, the men of the battalion gave many explanations and rationalizations for their actions. Many claimed not to have had a choice, or even not to have been fully conscious of the immorality of their actions. Others argued that the fate of the Jews was inevitable, so it didn't matter who pulled the trigger. But there were definitely more factors at play here. To a limited extent, a certain amount of trickery was involved, but even once made fully aware of their task, most of the men continued to participate. Another major factor seems to have been peer pressure and camaraderie. Perhaps the horror of their task made the men of the battalion more likely to participate, as none wanted to leave their comrades to go through it alone. One strategy that multiple men attempted was distancing themselves from their task, and just not thinking about it. But one defense stood out so much that the author quotes it verbatim, and I think it's worth repeating here. "I made the effort, and it was possible for me, to shoot only children. It so happened that the mothers led the children by the hand. My neighbor then shot the mother, and I shot the child that belonged to her, because I reasoned with myself that after all, without its mother, the child could not live any longer. It was supposed to be, so to speak, soothing to my conscience to release children unable to live without their mothers." That's shocking enough, but it gets worse. As the author then explains, the full weight of this statement and the significance of the word choice of the former policeman cannot be fully appreciated unless one knows that the German word for release, Erlösen, also means to redeem or save when used in a religious sense. The one who releases is the Erlöser, the savior or redeemer. But rationalization can only get the men so far, as the unit very rapidly descended into mass alcohol abuse. Their leadership knew that the unit wouldn't be good for much longer, and so modified their function. Instead of murdering the victims themselves, the men would only have to round them up. Then, once gathered, the prisoners could be sent off to other, more specialized units for immediate execution, or onto trains bound for death and work camps. But that didn't mean the unit was totally done with murder, because if during a roundup a policeman encountered someone too old, too weak, or too young to be transported, they would be executed on the spot. Once again, nearly the entire unit complied, with the rest only disappearing until it was over, or getting themselves reassigned. Although parts of the unit would participate in additional mass killings, just like their first one at Josefo, as well as hunting down escapees out in the woods, something which the men would later rationalize as anti-partisan or anti-bandit activity. Ordinary Men is a book which naturally forces you to think about what you'd do in that kind of situation. And when I say you, I specifically mean you, the people watching this video, because in that situation, I'd most likely be the one getting shot. So ha! Oh, wait a minute. But in all seriousness, it's an important question. Just what are you supposed to do when ordered by a superior to commit an atrocity? The men of Reserve Police Battalion 101 went along with it. What makes you think you'd do anything different? Near the end of the Gulag Archipelago, Solzhenitsyn comments, "This is surely the main problem of the 20th century. Is it permissible merely to carry out orders and commit one's conscience to someone else's keeping? Can a man do without ideas of his own about good and evil, and merely derive them from the printed instructions and verbal orders of his superiors? Oaths. Those solemn pledges pronounced with a tremor in the voice and intended to defend the people against evildoers. See how easily they can be misdirected to the service of evildoers and against the people." And since we've already started, let's continue to talk about the Gulag Archipelago. It's one of the best books I've ever read. But a proper analysis would take way too long to fit into this video, so instead, I'll first say that you really should read it, even if it's only the abridged version. And second, I want to share with you some anecdotes and excerpts from the work that I found particularly memorable and worthwhile. When I talked about ordinary men, some of you may have wondered what the perpetrators of these atrocities would have thought if they were in their victims' positions. Perhaps a little more empathy would have helped. Well, Solzhenitsyn gives us a hint at the answer. He describes what happened to radical Orthodox communists who became victims of their own system like this. Here's the sort of people they were. Olga Sliosberg's husband had already been arrested, and they had come to carry out a search and arrest her too. The search lasted 4 hours, and she spent those 4 hours sorting out the minutes of the Congress of Stakhanovites of the bristle and brush industry, of which she had been the secretary until the previous day. The incomplete state of the minutes troubled her more than her children, whom she was leaving forever. Even the interrogator conducting the search could not resist telling her, "Come on now, say farewell to your children." Here's the sort of people they were. A letter from her 15-year-old daughter came to Yelizaveta Svetkova in the Kazan prison for long-term prisoners. "Mama, tell me, write to me, are you guilty or not? I hope you weren't guilty, because then I won't join the Komsomol, and I won't forgive them because of you. But if you are guilty, I won't write you anymore, and will hate you." And the mother was stricken by remorse in her damp and grief-like cell with its dim little lamp. How could her daughter live without the Komsomol? How could she be permitted to hate Soviet power? Better that she should hate me. And so she wrote, "I am guilty. Enter the Komsomol." And that is the price a man pays for entrusting his God-given soul to human dogma. Here's another more humorous anecdote, or at least humorous only here in the West, as Solzhenitsyn explains. They were building an apartment building, and free employees stole several bathtubs, but the tubs had been supplied to match the number of apartments, so how could they hand over the apartment building as completed? They could not confess to the construction superintendent, of course. He was triumphantly showing the official acceptance committee around the first stair landing. Yes, and he did not omit to take them into every bathroom too, and show them each tub. And then he took the committee to the second floor landing, and the third, not hurrying there either, and kept going into all the bathrooms. And meanwhile, the adroit and experienced Zax, under the leadership of an experienced foreman plumber, broke bathtubs out of the apartments on the first landing, hauled them upstairs on tiptoe to the fourth floor, and hurriedly installed and puttied them in before the committee's arrival. This ought to be shown in a film comedy, but they wouldn't allow it. There's nothing funny in our life. Everything funny takes place in the West. And last, I'll read you a story of a heroic child, no older than 14. It starts when the Western world hears rumors that the Soviet Union isn't quite the paradise it claimed to be. Eager to stamp out such vile slander, the Soviets send the great proletarian writer, Maxim Gorky, to tour a camp. He'll tell the truth. Of course, the camp was made nicer, the prisoners given better clothing, and the torture rooms cleared of their instruments. But the clever Zex found ways to hint that it was all a lie. But little hints weren't enough for one man. I'll let Solzhenitsyn take over from here. They went to the children's colony. How decent everything was there. Each was on a separate cot with a mattress. They all crowded around in a group, and all of them were happy. And all of a sudden, a 14-year-old boy said, "Listen here, Gorky, everything you see here is false. Do you want to know the truth? Shall I tell you?" "Yes," nodded the writer. Yes, he wanted to know the truth. "Oh, you bad boy, why did you want to spoil the just recently arranged prosperity of the literary patriarch, a palace in Moscow, an estate outside Moscow?" And so, everyone was ordered to leave. And the boy spent an hour and a half telling the whole story to the lanky old man. Gorky left the barracks, streaming tears. He was given a carriage to go to dinner at the villa of the camp chief, and the boys rushed back into the barracks. "Did you tell him about the mosquito treatment?" "Yes." "Did you tell him about the pole torture?" "Yes." "Did you tell him about the prisoners hitched up instead of horses?" "Yes." "And how they rolled them down the stairs?" "And about the sacks?" "And about being made to spend the night in the snow?" And it turned out that the truth-loving boy had told all, but we don't even know his name. On June 23rd, Gorky left Solovki. Hardly had a steamer pulled away from the pier than they shot the boy. Oh, great interpreter of the human heart, great connoisseur of human beings, how could he have failed to take the boy along with him? And he did publish his statement, and it was republished over and over in the big free press, both our own and that of the West, claiming it was nonsense to frighten people with Solovki, and that the prisoners lived remarkably well there and were being well reformed. Solzhenitsyn often directly addresses his reader, and addresses him in so many ways that no matter where he's from or who he is, a Westerner, a communist, a fellow Zach, he says something directly to him. He left a message for all of you too. I'll pass it on. All you freedom-loving left-wing thinkers in the West, you left laborites, you progressive American, German, and French students, as far as you're concerned, none of this amounts to much. As far as you're concerned, this whole book of mine is a waste of effort. You may suddenly understand it all someday, but only when you yourselves hear, hands behind your backs there, and step ashore on our archipelago. And that's the Gulag Archipelago versus Ordinary Men. Up next, we're going to shift our focus away from the victims and perpetrators of atrocities and onto their survivors. Specifically, a group of men and women who, even when the whole world tried to kill them, chose not to be victims, who chose to survive. And remarkably, in spite of their brutal conditions, thrived. I'll see you then.